So I've got a couple things inside of me, and I'm not sure how I'm going to accomplish this tonight, and or if I will accomplish it. We all set out to do great things for God, is what we all want to do something fantastic for God. And we're all looking for moments. We're all trying to find a moment in God to press into. We're trying to find a visitation. We're trying to find something. And a lot of times, all of that is dealing with our own self-worth, or our own value, or our own approval, or our own even recognition. And but what happens if we never attain any of those things? What happens if we don't get the approval or the recognition, or have that big moment, or we it just doesn't seem like it comes? And what if the only thing that you accomplish with your whole life is that when your life was done, it's pleased God, but yet it didn't please God by all of those things? It pleased God by your relationship with Him. And that's really what this all comes down to, because the extension of our relationship with Him is what's pleasing. And I mean, would you feel accomplished? Would you feel approved? Would you feel valued if that's all that you had at the end of your life? You ran your whole life, you ran your whole course, you ran everything out, and at the end, that was all that you had. And we think we're speaking about secret place, and I'm going to use a couple verses that are secret place verses. By thinking of a man by the name of Wade Taylor. Does anyone know who Wade Taylor is? Well, Wade Taylor was a conference speaker. He's a spiritual father. He was an overseer or a counselor. He was an author. He authored books. And in his last days, he authored a book called The Secret of the Stairs. And in that book, it started to lay out how he would conclude his life. And the conclusion of his life was that in his latter days, he refused to go to conferences and speak. He refused to even oversee things. He stepped back from everything that he was doing. And he saw it literally almost as like an empty work, because he had found this secret place of the stairs. And so what he would do in his last days, the last 2 years of his life, is he invited leaders to his house to engage into the presence of God, because he learned how to entertain the presence of God to the degree that he was so saturated in it that when people just got on his property, they couldn't even function. And leaders that were big conference leaders, big speakers, authors, famous people in the body of Christ, they would get on his property and they were dysfunctional in the presence of God. They did not know how to function. And he learned how to find that secret place, and he prized that secret place above all the accomplishments that he had done in earth. And that was literally how he ended his days, ministering to leaders, for leaders to finally feel and know the presence of God that had never really experienced it their whole ministry. So what was that secret place? It was intimacy. It was intimacy with God. It was intimacy in his relationship with God. It was intimacy that he valued God. He valued that moment in God more than any other moment of what he was doing. And so when you think about what I just said earlier about worship as part of the message, it's like literally what is happening in worship is God is trying to bring us into a place of intimacy to hear his heart. That's literally what goes on in worship. And if you don't connect into that part of that area of intimacy, it's hard to really get the full impact of what he wants to say in the message. And so, you know, where are we going to go? We're going to start back. I'm going to start back in Genesis. And we'll talk about Enoch in Genesis 5:18, really 5:21. And Enoch lived 65 years and begat Methuselah, and he begat Methuselah. Enoch walked with God 300 years and had sons and daughters. So all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Literally, that is, there's one other verse about Enoch in Hebrews, and we'll read that in a moment. Here's a man who walked with God, but only two verses were written. And in the time of Enoch, men were really, they were full of evil. There was so much evil going around, but yet in the midst of the evil, Enoch was walking with God. And in that time, many people stopped following God, stopped engaging into God, but yet Enoch walked with God. And in that time, men refused to listen to what God's messengers were saying. And yet Enoch continued to walk with God. So when you look at the word walk, he walked with God. The word walk means there was a manner of life that he was doing. It means to proceed into something, to die to something. And he was dying to his own self, and he was dying to his own desires. But when you start to look at the word walk, it actually means to ascend and return. So he had found, like Wade Taylor, the secret stairs, the place of ascending and returning, ascending and returning, ascending and returning. And it means to appear to have died and return from death. So when Enoch was walking with God, it doesn't necessarily mean like we think of walking with God as like that I know who God is, so I'm automatically walking with him. It literally, the word walk means up and down, to and fro, in and out of God. So he's up and down in God. He's to and fro in God, the vastness of God. And he's in and out of God. He's coming into that secret place in God's heart and coming back out of that secret place and going back into that secret place and coming back in. And that became the walk, the manner of life. He lived a life of that kind of closeness with God. I think it's really, and it says that he did it with him, meaning it, the word with means in relationship with. He was doing it with his relationship with God. So there was times that his relationship would be up or down, but yet God was still in the midst of the up and the down. There was times it was in and out, to and fro. There was times that he would go in and he would come back and he would appear as if he had died. Probably he was overwhelmed in the glory of God and just he appeared that way to everybody around him. But it also means, the word with means to cause to meet something, to have a union for a reason to have communion, to have a union. We talk about unity, we talk about oneness. In John 17, well, the oneness that Enoch experienced is literally the oneness that God is wanting us to experience that will bring us into a oneness in the body of Christ. The oneness is not necessarily going to come corporately, even though it is. It's going to come individually, participating corporately. So individuals are all responsible. You're all responsible for your walk with God and your disciplines in God, and you're discipling of yourself by the Holy Spirit discipling you. You're literally without excuse of why you cannot do what God asks us to do. And so when he walked with God, it caused him to meet God. You see, this is what should be happening in our so-called, I'm walking with God. We should be having encounters with him on a regular basis, like on a daily basis. There should be encounter after encounter after encounter, going through our day, walking out our relationship with him. And so there was a man called St. Lawrence. Anybody hear of St. Lawrence? Brother Lawrence. Brother Lawrence so walked like this with God that when he did the dishes, people would come to watch him do the dishes because he wasn't doing dishes. He was engaged in the eternal realm with God and dialoguing with God as he did the dishes. And doing the most mundane thing was the most intense thing for people of the day to engage into, because they weren't engaging into it like that. But that was a time when he wasn't even truly fully focused, because he was doing mundane tasks, but because of doing them, he was like, my life is with God. So everything that I do is with God. Every moment of my day I'm spending with God. And as I do the most mundane thing, God is in the midst having relationship with me. And he learned how to walk with God in that kind of intensity. So here's kind of how I put it. Intimacy is an overlapping of heaven and earth. It's an overlapping of us upon the earth, overlapping with heaven, and engaging into it in a very intimate way. Not just engaging because we sang a song and I feel good because we sang a song, or I got a little promise in the word and now that promise means something to me. It's like the walking out, the totality of that very thing. That's what intimacy is. Psalms 91:1 says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High, you all know this, shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Well, how close are you? Very close. You're right there where the shadow is overtaking you. Kind of like Peter's shadow. Psalms 81:7, thou callest in trouble, I delivered thee, I answered thee in the secret place of thunder. So the answer came in the secret place. And so we've had secret men engaging in secret places for a long time. It started out as contemplative prayer. Contemplating what was going to happen. Contemplative prayer actually evolved from what was called the Desert Fathers. And the Desert Fathers evolved from, contemplative prayer evolved from mystical theology. Meaning that there was mysteries of God that was yet to be discovered and written down, because the vastness of God was so vast that when people got into the eternal realm or into the spiritual realm, they started discovering like pathways into all that God had created that we have yet to even experience. And so it was called mystical theology. And mystical theology came from intimacy. So that's kind of how it evolved. The intimacy of the early church evolved into a what was called mystical theology that evolved into contemplative prayer that evolves into what we have today. Now, some of what we have today has kind of lost the kazing because we don't talk about intimacy. We very seldom practice intimacy. We don't even understand what it means to be intimate with God. And yet the early church, that's where they were at. They understood these things. So now, what contributes to intimacy is contemplation. Contemplation. And I told this to Connie today. Jesus did 3 years of ministry. Here we are. We all want to go out and let's pound it and do ministry and have big results and tear things down and create stuff and da-da-da. Jesus did 3 years of ministry, and we always say it like this, and he had 30 years of preparation. He had 30 years of contemplation. 30 years contemplating what he would do in his 3 years. 30 years contemplating what God had already said, his Father had said. Contemplating all the things that he knew, that he had the inside track in. And I believe he sat there and contemplated about what he was going to do with his life, the impact that it was going to hold, how he would have to suffer. He contemplated all of those things out. And I believe that we are in a season of contemplation in the church right now. We are about to enter into ministry to go and accomplish all the things that we want to do, but we're in a contemplation, and I'm going to tell you where your contemplation is supposed to be taking you, not contemplating about all the stuff going on in the world, but contemplating about your secret place and your intimacy with God to get into that place you're supposed to be in. You're supposed to be contemplating about every promise that's been given. You're supposed to be contemplating about the anointings and giftings that you're carrying. You're supposed to be contemplating about the investment God has made in us, the message that He's given to us, the assignments that He's placed upon us. These are all supposed to be our contemplations. And I've been in a contemplation for about 2 years about all these things. I'm still contemplating. I'm studying into some things. I'm going into some intimacy with God about some things. But I'm contemplating this vast thing that's setting on my life. Because I can't figure out how to make it all work. I can't figure out how to step into all of it. But I can contemplate about it. And whether I get there or not, what it's doing is it's driving me into greater intimacy. Because that's the only place I'm going to find my answers for all my contemplations. We're not going to find answers about all the world's problems. The problems will never all go away until there's a new heavens, a new earth. So we're contemplating and we're contemplating. And I believe Jesus contemplated. And I know Enoch was contemplating stuff. He's seeing things in the eternal realm. If you read the book of Enoch, he's seeing all of that. And he's contemplating, how do I voice this to these people because they will not receive it? How do I have this vast understanding and all this knowing about God? And how is that to come into the earth? What am I to do with what he has shown me? So back to Mr. Enoch. And Enoch's not my main topic tonight. What does contemplation do? It does. There's two things that start to go into play as you contemplate, as you build your intimacy, as you start to move. You walk before God, which is a life of devotion to God. You walk before Him, which is your devotional life, your prayer life, your study life. It's your tarry life. It is how you tarry before God, how you wait, the seriousness of purpose, more than the actions of studying and reading your Bible. The pat answer is read your Bible and pray, which becomes a religious answer. It's about a relationship. So it comes down to tarrying, intimacy, engaging your spirit, telling your head to shut up, telling your body to go do, crawl out of bed, pray. But your prayer life is not praying. Your prayer life is engaging in God in intimacy. So it becomes your walk before God, your devotional life. But what else Enoch did is he walked with God. Not before God. Right now, the whole church is walking before God, and very few are walking with God. Walking with God is a life of communion with God. An ongoing communion, an ongoing dialogue. It's when you start to walk with God, you are carrying God's presence because God is with you, alongside you. When you're walking before God, you're walking in anointings and giftings. You're walking in callings. But when you're walking with God, you're walking with presence. You're walking with Shekinah glory. You're walking with something resting on your own life because he's resting with you. He is like carrying you. He is the one bringing you, taking you, moving you. Does that make sense? So Enoch, this is mind-blowing. He learned to walk with God for 365 years. We do good if we can get a couple years in at the end of our life. like Wade Taylor. He found the secret to the stairs, found the way to walk with God, not the way to be before God. And so it's like, so there's a big challenge, isn't there? So that walking, yeah, I better keep moving, hadn't I? Has to be a walk of intimate communion, walking with God. Has to be that walk of intimate communion. So what does that mean? When two friends walk together, that communion is secret. No one understands how two walk together if two be agreed as touching anything. It's like a secret formula, isn't it? Secret sauce. We do this, this will happen. There's something going on in the walking of communion together. And the communion is between you and God, and it's a secret of how you understand God and how God walks with you. It becomes a very personal thing. When two people walk together, their conversation is on the same level. How can two, unless they agree? It's on the same level. That's like there's people I can have unbelievable conversation with, and there's people I have shallow conversation with. And there's people that I can do certain things with because we're at that same understanding and level, and so I can walk with them, alongside them. Okay? Number three, when two friends walk together, their wills and governing feelings are the same. You start coming into the place of agreement. You come into the place that you are both feeling the same thing, agreeing to the same thing. The governing factors become the same thing. I can give you a story. You've heard it before, but it plays right into this. It's like I walked with a man so much in a building program that I knew how he thought. I knew what he believed. And when he walked up to me to ask me a question, I would answer him before he asked the question, and he would walk away knowing I had the answer right. He didn't have to explain himself. And our pastor was just losing it, like, how do you know how to respond? I said, because we have walked together. So I know how he thinks. I know his heart. He knows my heart. We're able to share. We're able to go do these things. And it was exactly how it was. And you think, well, that's crazy. Well, we were tearing down a house, a log chain broke, and he was coming to ask me to buy that guy a new log chain. And I just said, he didn't ask. I just said, yes, we will. And he turned around, walked away, and I went and bought a new log chain, and we presented it to him on Sunday because that's what he wanted to do. And we didn't have any conversation. Now, my pastor was just blown. It was warping his mind. And I'm like, if you'll just get in the spirit for a moment, you can walk like that. But both have to be in the spirit. So what's happening is when you're walking together, you have allowed your spirit to walk with God's spirit. It's not your flesh walking. It's not your mind. It's your spirit walking with him. Number four, you keep the same course because you have the same objective. When you're walking with somebody, probably you're going to the same destination. So you go off on a walk. You don't like, hey, can you go with a walk for me? You go down that path and I'll go over here. Well, that don't work too good. So you're going in the same path. But who's leading the path? He is. He's taking every stone of stumbling out of the way. Is he not? He's wanting you to come alongside the path. So it isn't like he's kicking the stones out of his way. He's kicking the stones out of both of your way, and you're going down the same path together. So when all this occurred, God took him. God took Enoch, which means to seize him. He literally grabbed him and held him and seized him, and he took him. Because why? The friendship was so tight. The heart so connected. The path so the same. That God is like, I'm going to seize you, Enoch. I'm going to take you. If you start to study it out, you actually find out it's because God basically said, I don't know why I'm wasting my time sending you back down there. They don't want to listen. Why don't you just stay here because you're just like me? Just hang out here. And he seized him and he was no more, Hebrews says. He was no more. He's gone. When you read the book of Enoch, you see that Enoch saw the seraphim and the cherubim, and he saw the Ophion. And the Ophion means the wheels of Ezekiel personified. He saw the wheels, but the life of the wheels. He saw the living of the wheels. I don't even know how to describe it. But one of the other things he saw is he saw his identity. And he saw his value. And in the book of Enoch, it says this, the Lord opened his eyes to see who he was in heaven. Man, if that's something to think about. We're wanting our eyes open to see who we are here. And God opened his eyes to say, no, you need to see who you are in heaven. Yeah. Ever think? I mean, that's out there stuff, isn't it? This is who you are. Man, we ought to be praying, God, open my eyes so I see who I am in heaven. Who are you on the earth? Who am I to you, God? Who am I? What am I doing? And it says that his testimony pleased God, and he was translated. And the word please is only used three times in Scripture, twice with Enoch, and one other time talking about a righteous man. So it's like he was translated. So here's how he was translated. I put it like this. God's hand was literally so upon him that when God's hand withdrew, he was so connected to God, it withdrew him in the hand of God. Isn't that amazing? Well, there's my introduction. Now we get back to this other part. So, intimacy, pleasing God. Peter, James, and John. Peter, James, and John were three key guys in the history of the church. Very key. James led the first church age, which released the apostolic age into the earth. Peter leads the apostolic age and releases the revelatory age. John takes the revelatory age and releases the kingdom age. Do like a class for 4 hours just on that right there. James is the first leader of the church in Jerusalem. James is also the first martyr in the book of Acts. Now, Stephen was basically stoned there, but I'm talking about an apostle that was leading, a leader that was taken out. And the thing they all had was intimacy. They all had intimacy with Christ. And that was an empowering thing for them to be able to take on these responsibilities and these assignments and these things. Their lives basically were pleasing to God, even though Peter kind of had some situations there at times. But he was seeking revelation, because remember, that's what he was leading, was revelation. And so he pressed into that place and he said, I'm seeing something in the secret place. And then he gets off on his own flesh, and then he gets rebuked, and then he has to go through some repentance, and then he goes through, you know, it's all that. But it kind of goes like this, John 13:23, now there was one leaning on Jesus' bosom of his disciples whom Jesus loved. And he's talking about John. And John was so close, he was hearing the heartbeat of God. Think about that. Intimacy was making him want to be there and lay his head on Jesus' chest, and he was hearing Jesus' heartbeat. Can you imagine? You see, here's what intimacy will do for you. It will release privilege to you. It will release situations for you to have an advantage that no one else gets. Jesus loved John. I think he loved them all, but why would it point out in Scripture that he loved him? Because there was something that was, he was coming after him. He was pursuing. He was pressing. John 20, verse 2, then she runneth and come to Simon Peter and the other disciple whom Jesus loved. Well, who is that? That's Peter and James. So he has all three of them set aside as ones that he loved because they were doing some action that he loved. And I think the action wasn't like, you know, it wasn't like they were all perfect people. The action was they were attempting, they were trying, they were coming, they were pressing, they were doing what they could do. Their hearts were connected. Oh, skip that. Isn't it amazing that Peter, James, and John were the only three apostles that embraced Paul in Galatians 2:9 as an apostle? Why is that? Because the intimacy that they were experiencing was the intimacy that Paul was experiencing. And it was resonating in their spirit. These men had privileges. Paul had privilege, didn't he? Why did they have privileges? Because their hearts were connected with the mission of Christ in the earth. And they were having intimacy in the mission, and intimacy in the messenger, and intimacy in the message. And so what intimacy starts to do, it starts to inflame your heart with motivation. It starts to put your heart into an engagement, and you start to begin to move with things. Intimacy will free you from your insecurities and your fear of men. When you get intimate with God, your fear starts disappearing. You don't fear many things. Intimacy will also do this. It will fill every void in your soul. The need of self-recognition, the need of approval, the need of this, the need of that. It will fulfill all of those things. So here's probably the biggest thing that starts to happen then. Intimacy begins to create your passions. And your passions begin reflecting, hopefully, his heart more than your own heart. The transformation starts to occur, that there's a reflection going on inside of you. And so you can always tell what someone is passionate about because it's what they talk about. People are passionate about COVID crud. It's terrible. Where is the church passionate about Christ and talking about him, or passionate about the kingdom, or passionate about what God is doing on the face of the earth? You see, what you are passionate about is what you're going to talk about. What you're passionate about is what you will spend your resources on. What you will put your time into. What you will devote to a task or an assignment. What you're passionate about is going to lead you into a greater understanding of even the mundane things, like Brother Lawrence. That you see that it's not like I compartmentalize my walk in God, my walk with God. He is with me all the time. So I'm moving into that thing with him. So whether I'm sitting in this room cleaning something, he is with me in the cleaning of it. He probably will talk to me about all kinds of secret things about my cleaning. And it isn't about pieces of lint that you missed. It's about people's lives that'll be influenced as they put their face to the carpet. Give you assignments of who to pray for. All kinds of things. Intimacy always comes and brings privileges. Privileges, because I've been spending that intimate time with God in that secret place, that hidden place. It's like he's going to allow me to go places that I never thought about going and do things that I never thought about doing. And I'm sitting here thinking I'm not equipped. And he said to Moses, I will go with you. You don't feel like you're eloquent of speech, Moses? I will go with you. You don't feel like you got enough men, Gideon? I will go with you. You see, if you do not have intimacy, what you have is excuses. Every time. I can't do this. I'm the least of my father's house. I am uneducated. I am this and that. And we come up with list after list after list of excuses. And God's like, I got a trump card and it's called, I go with you. If I go with you, then what are you afraid of? If I go with you, I'll fill your mouth in the selfsame hour. I'll give you the words. I will go with you. You see? So you get privilege. And here were some of the privileges that these three guys, Peter, James, and John, they were all there at the raising of Jairus' daughter. They were privileged to see death be conquered. They were all privileged to be at the Mount of Transfiguration and see Jesus transformed, where literally he becomes radiant glory, illuminating. Literally it says he was glistening, which means like lightning bolts are coming off of him. And they're seeing this. And you know what they say? We cannot tell anybody about this. Probably because nobody's going to believe them because nobody's in intimacy. But we can probably talk about this amongst ourselves because we all experienced and saw it. Can you imagine the privilege of that? And yet in the place, he's trying to bring them into deeper places of intimacy, deeper. And he's like, let's go to the garden and pray. And their thought of prayer, because they're not walking with God, even though they were walking with Jesus, he's walking with God, but their mind is prayer is a religious thing we do. And Jesus is like, no, guys, I'm going to have a dialogue with my Father that I want you to participate in and listen to. And I'm asking him a very important question in this moment. And I've brought you into what? The greatest moment of my life. You see, when you walk with God, you're not walking into the greatest moments of your life. You're walking into the greatest moments of Him. And in that moment, they all do what? Fall asleep. Amazing. And He comes again. And He wakes them up a second time. And you know what he does? He goes and he prays the same prayer to the Father again. Why is he praying the same prayer? Did he not get the answer? He's praying the same prayer so they have a chance to have intimacy. You see what's going on? God has long patience with us, but eventually it runs out and he goes, I got to get onto the cross. So if you guys missed your moment, you missed your moment, but I got to get on. So intimacy is a way that God creates faith and belief in us. It's where he starts to empower us with places to build up who we are and what we'll do on the earth. Are you all kind of, you done? I'll skip that. Yeah, Peter, John, prepare Passover, Luke 22:8. They go to prepare that Passover before they go into the garden. Intimacy will give you responsibility for the plan of God. He gives them divine direction. Amazing, isn't it? And he says it like this. Find a house, find an upper room, prepare a meal. So they're looking for a house, and they're looking for an upper room, and they're looking for a meal. Find a house, Find the church, the ecclesia. Find an upper room. Find the heart of that ecclesia. Prepare a meal. Bring a covenant, a cup of covenant, a transformation process into the heart of the ecclesia. It literally is like a hidden mystery that you think you're going to do a natural assignment when everything in God is a spiritual assignment. There is a spiritual meaning behind everything he does. But if we are only walking before God, we do natural things with no understanding of spiritual assignment. But if we're walking with God, the eyes of our understanding are enlightened, and we know the hope of our calling. Ephesians. We start to move into those dynamics. Peter, James, and John go into the garden. Privileged to be there in that final moment. They go into the upper room in Acts 1:13. Peter, James, and John are there. What is it about, this outpouring? And he's like, I don't want you to hear about it. I want you to be with me in it. You see, the outpouring of the Spirit upon you is not for you to walk before God. It's for you to walk with God. Look at how many of these things are about us being with him, him empowering us to go do the works that he's called us to do. They come out of the upper room, and who's sitting at the gate beautiful? Peter and John. Guys that had intimacy were guys that shaped how the church began to function in the early days. This is what's coming in this hour in America. Because everybody's walking before God and almost nobody walking with God. What happens if everybody starts walking with God? Think of the impact that we will have. Think of what we can do, all of us walking together with God. That's the John 17 fulfillment. But we're walking before God and hoping God blesses instead of walking with God and knowing he's blessing. You see, we walk before God in hopes of something. We walk with God in the knowing of something. So it's like a huge paradigm difference between the two places. And in the early church, what's the missing link that they had that we don't have? They were not walking before God as much as they were walking with God. And God was leading, and God was directing, and God was speaking, and God was declaring, and God filled Peter's mouth, and he said, this is that. And God moved on hearts of conviction when he spoke, and God healed the man at the gate beautiful. But see, when we don't do that, we're over here walking before God, and we're hoping my anointing will do it, or my faith will do it, or my understanding will make it happen, and this dude will get healed, and something will go on. And over here walking with God, it's like, well, let's just raise the dead then. Well, it's pretty simple because life is walking with me. I'm not having to engage life. I have life with me. He, the one that created, the one that's dead is with me. He knows what's wrong. He knows what's going on. He can do this. But see, when we don't walk with him, we're over here walking before him. And then we're asking him these questions and going, what do you want to do? I hope this works. Hope I don't look foolish. We go through all these hoops, and he's wanting us to deepen our relationship into that place of real intense intimacy. Real intense intimacy. When you get intimacy, you gain confidence. When you get intimacy, you gain boldness. Acts 4. They prayed. Were they praying over here before God, or were they praying with God? Oh, I know God wants to give us boldness, and I know he wants to give us this, and I know he wants signs and wonders, and I know he wants miracles. How do I know that? Because I'm with him. What does God want right now in the earth? He wants an awakening, and he wants an outpouring, and he wants revival, and he wants whatever tag you want to put on it. And that's our problem, is we're over here walking before God trying to figure out a tag instead of walking with God and just doing what he wants to do. So we're waiting for it to come, and it's already came, and it's here, and it's upon us, and he's with us, and we can go out and do the exploits. We can do anything that Jesus did. That's why Jesus said, greater works will you do than these. Because I go to the Father, and I'm leaving the Holy Spirit for you to go do the works. So he's going to walk with you in life and through life. And you're going to do all kinds of crazy stuff. And do you realize that there are things that the apostles did that Jesus did not do? And that will warp us if we like meditate into that a little bit. Nobody got anybody saved pre-Christ. The apostles got people saved after Christ. No one got spirit-filled pre-Christ. Everyone got spirit-filled after Christ. Jesus didn't turn the world upside down, but the 12 men turned the world upside down. The extension of him, all the extensions of walking with God, created all of this life flow in the earth and shifted all of history. I mean, I better end. Peter and John go to Samaria and lay a foundation there. So Peter begins giving us the beginning, leading us into the church. Then James takes the church. Then Peter transitions the church into that revelatory thing, which enables Paul to come as the great revelator upon the earth to write the books, to put the things out that we read today. And then how it ends is John, and John ends talking about the end of the age in Revelation 4. It's amazing, isn't it? So it's kind of like this. Acts opens up with the guys that had intimacy, and the book closes with the guys that had intimacy. It's wild. Now we sit here today and we love to have intimacy because we love the goosebumps. We love holy laughter gets cranked out and everybody's blitzed. We love it. You all look like this. No one loves any of it, I guess. I'll talk to the stream. You all love it on the stream, don't you? I know where you're all from. You all love it. But you see, it's like, what does he want in this hour? What does he want to do with us? What are we carrying? What have we been created for? Why are we here? I'm contemplating a lot of why am I in Des Moines, Iowa? I go a lot of places. Why am I here? If what I'm called to do here does not materialize, God, would you please release me? I don't want to waste my life here. I want to walk with you where you're going. Right now, this is where I'm at because this is where you said to be. You're here. What are we going to do being here? What are you going to do being here? You've just moved here. What are you going to do being here? Why are you here? Why are we all here tonight? Did you come here to hear me? Did you come here to worship? Did you come here to be with him? You see, big difference. If we're here with him, then what is he wanting to do with you? Exactly. And if he's taking one of us somewhere, he's probably taking a lot of us someplace. Yeah. He's wanting us to go somewhere with him, and he's really wanting us to understand that there's an assignment, like they understood there was an assignment. We're going to take this gospel to the world. We have a big assignment. I'm overwhelmed. I can't do any of it. Yeah, that's because I'm before God. If I'm with God, what can I not do? If he gave me his son, what would he withhold from me? If he can accomplish all the things that I read, why can he not accomplish those things in my life and through me now? You see, it's like we have to change our paradigm thinking and our perceptions of him and start to walk with him, alongside with him. those desert fathers. You ever read about the desert fathers? It's amazing, the stories. They were monks that just said, I'm tired of the nonsense of Christianity and the world and the foolishness of men and their approaches. And they just went out into the desert and like, they didn't check out. They got in intimacy with God. They got in secret places. They got in those places with him and they stayed there. There's stories of them like, and this monk stayed 20 years with God. Intimate with God. And people visited him and said, why are you here? And he said, because God told me there's a day that we're going to walk out. And we're going to have a multitude to preach to. And like, how are you going to do that out here in the desert? No one comes to the desert. You're out here by yourself in the desert. He says, you'll see. And there was a day that came. And he came out of his cave, went out, and stood on this like plateau. And there was 20,000 people that came supernaturally to the desert. And he sat there and preached the gospel to them. And it was so powerful because of 20 years of locked away intimacy in the secret place. My gosh. You know, it's like what I've said. It's like we sit and tarry for 10 minutes and preach for an hour and nothing happens. The average pastor prays 5 minutes in America. In case you didn't know. It's been that way for years. And we can't figure out why we have no results. 5 minutes, I can't even find the door to heaven in 5 minutes. You know what I'm saying? It's like, so where's that place of intimacy where we lock away hour, 2 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours, 10 hours, locked away a few days in the upper room with God, not seeking God, with God. See the difference? Everything we do is about being before him instead of being with him. Now I'm locked away with him. And now I come out of being locked away with him and I shoot my guns and things happen. People are annihilated. I used to do this a lot and I was full time. I would spend hours in my office, hours. She can test hours just, and I was with God. And I'm longing for it again because I'm not getting that time. I was with God, with God, with God. People walk in my office. They couldn't even function. They just start weeping. Why? I was with God. And I'm like, what's going on? Presence of God's just so heavy. I can't even stand. And they just collapse. Being with him. That's how we used to do our services. We would come in the warehouse building, in the echo chamber. It's the echo chamber. We have all these names for these places we were at. Echo chamber was the first building we actually had. And it was concrete walls, concrete ceiling, concrete everything. So it was the echo chamber. And it was about this size. And in the echo chamber, we would come early to be with God, not to pray. So we came early to be with God. We would be with God. And God would show. And his presence was so heavy that when people came for the service, they couldn't make it but 10 or 15 feet in the room and they'd fall out. And when we start the service, we've had 30 plus people laid out on the floor as we got ready to start a service because God had already met with them. They didn't come to the service to be met. God met with them when they came through that door because we came to be with him, not to come and pray. And you see the big difference. And it's like, so think of the early church. They gathered to be with him. They were everywhere with him. Were they not everywhere? Yeah, they were doing some praying. I mean, in places you can see where they read, they were praying. But they were praying as they were with him. So you know what? It was kind of like this. Instead of us making our grocery list and our shopping list and sending it up, they're turning and having a dialogue with him about prayer. they're with him and they're like having a conversation. What would you like to see? Okay, let's do that. And I'm in agreement with you more so than I'm in agreement with you. Right. Where two agree is touching anything. So him and me are a majority and we can have whatever he wants to have. It's like, I don't even have to do the thinking anymore. So I'm contemplating. That's what this was about somewhat, wasn't it? I'm contemplating all of these kinds of things right now. I'm contemplating my future. I'm contemplating the words given. I found a word today that God gave me 10 years ago about Enoch and Revelation. And I'm contemplating that, finding that today. I'm contemplating a dream I had this week. Was this week or last week? I'm contemplating. Are you all contemplating? Aren't you all isn't the whole church contemplating? Trying to find the next path, trying to find the way forward, trying to find the answers, trying to find, like, how can this make sense? This whole thing that's going on in our nation it's literally God is using it to clean up the church and probably even divide it to a large degree. We can't seem to sort ourselves, so he'll just do it for us. He'll sort us out. And he'll get us down to what's most precious, because that's his pattern in life, you know, Gideon and different ones. I'm going to bring this down. I don't need vast numbers. I just need the contemplators, the ones looking for intimacy, the ones that want to walk with me. And if you want to walk with me, then as soon as you step over to walk with me, I'm probably going to tell you a mystery. It's been hid for this moment of time. I'm probably going to release, and this is what God's been telling me. We have the sound. This is my dream I had this week. Remind me, I'm supposed to call her too. We have the sound, but we don't have the structure to hold the sound or the way to protect the sound leaving us. And what's coming is the structure is coming and the way to protect the sound so it doesn't drop is coming. The sound is setting in people right now. The sound of heaven, and it's a sound of those that have walked with God, and they're carrying his sound, they're carrying his heartbeat, they're carrying his intention, they're carrying his frequency, they're carrying what he wants to do in the earth, but they're having a hard time finding the structure to place the sound, and the sound is not being protected. And that was part of the dream I had. That was a very small part of it. So it's like, you know, Enoch, I believe, had a sound that came from heaven into the earth. Yeah. I believe these Peter, James, and John had sounds from heaven that came into the earth, that released the history of God into the earth, that released the creativity of God, that just shifted everything. And so I believe that same thing is setting in a lot of people in this hour, and it's like, and I'm contemplating that. You know, which is meditating. I'm meditating in it. I'm studying it. I'm meditating. I'm contemplating. It's like, I'm mulling it over and over and over and over and over. You want to know how you get revelation? Contemplation. Mm-hmm. You know how I get a lot of the revelation? It's like I have to sit and meditate into something. And meditate in and meditate in and meditate in and meditate in. What I used to do is I used to take the whiteboard, come to worship practice, put the whiteboard up here, and allow the Spirit of God to speak to me in the atmosphere of worship. Because the worship practice was not a practice, it was just worship. It was to learn how to flow with each other. So it was prophetic flow. Worship team would flow, and they'd flow for a couple, 3 hours. And then officially close the practice, and then everybody would have jam session for an hour or two. And I would like write on the board, and the Lord gave me revelation after revelation after revelation, because I got into that secret place with him in the midst of all that, because what it was doing was bringing the sound of heaven into the atmosphere, and then I was stepping into the atmosphere, and then I was with him, and then he's talking to me about things, and I'm just writing it down. I don't know where to go with all that. But that's what I have tonight for everybody. Be a friend with God, like Enoch was. Come into that secret place with him. Start contemplating your life. Start pursuing your time in a different way. Break your patterns that are causing you to be before God instead of being with God. Press till you get into the place with Him. Stay in that place with Him. Allow Him to form you in that place. And I think we're going to see, literally I believe it's kind of like we're going to see a company of like Enoch type people. Do you realize that Enoch's one of the anointings for Iowa? It's one of the four anointings in the state. We have yet to engage that. We see the Joseph anointing very prevalent with entrepreneurialism. And we're seeing the Isaiah, and we're even seeing the Daniel, the statesman prophet. We see all of the, but the Enoch one is the one we have not quite engaged, the friend of God. It's setting here, but we have not fully, like, we haven't stepped into it as a state. And I believe that's where God wants us. See, it's easier to go, it's easier to come, like tomorrow morning, it's going to be so easy to come over here and just be before God. Nothing's required of me when I'm over here before God. Hope the worship team does a good job and I can get my goosebumps today. Hope the pastor's got a good message. I'm before God. It's a little more work to come over here and be with God. A little more required of a heart search. A little more required of a seriousness of purpose. A little more required of your own disciplines. Because this over here requires you to be committed, not others. You see? And so as leaders, as myself as a leader, I'm supposed, and this is the greatest challenge I have, is I'm supposed to be bringing you, dragging, kicking, screaming somehow, to be over here with God, not to come here on Saturday nights and just be before God. Right. Somehow you've all got to come over to be with God. I got to be over there. You have to be there. That's where God wants to take us. Mm-hmm. We get over with God, it's like we're unstoppable. And see, that's what Jesus knew. He knew, he said, the whole religious structure up to the time of the cross has been before me. After the cross, I'm bringing them with me. That's why you'll do greater works than me. Because I'm going to be involved in everything after this. Well, Father, tonight we thank you for your word. Break it open to us in the days to come and bring it as life. Holy Spirit, may you bring us into the places we're supposed to be with the Father and the Son and you. And Father, may you just be glorified in all of our lives tonight, Father. God, you challenge us. Let us see the things that we must shift, change, and bring into a right alignment that we can come into greater intimacy with you. Holy Spirit, convict us of the places where we're falling short. Convict us of the things we must give way to or get rid of. And Holy Spirit, would you do a work in us to change what we really value? Create the passion of the Father's heart within us. Father, I thank you for these things. I thank you for the people on the stream tonight. God, may you do the same with all of them. Father, we thank you for healing for Connie. We thank you, God, that you would touch her body. We thank you, God, tonight that you would bring a wholeness to her. We thank you for others that we know of, God, that are fighting sickness and disease, cancers and different things. We curse those things that are not of you. And we say, Father, would you bring a wholeness to them? Would you move them from being before you to being with you so those things will die in them? And there's a revelation right there. Father, I thank you for these things tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, fellowship, love each other. If you have a need, get with somebody to pray with you. Yeah, there's a revelation, isn't there?
Yep.
Before, with, it has to die.